involved in that development.
Let's go ahead and call the March 28th, 2017 St. Lucie County School Board meeting to order, or workshop to order. And good morning to our TV hosts, those that are on TV. And thank you, Mr. Superintendent, for bringing us up to date today. Please go ahead and take over.
Okay, good morning. Thanks, everybody. Getting over a little weather, so if the throat, I'm good. I'm ready to go. So
weather, it looks tan.
No game time decision. I'm ready to play today. Anyway, we have an opportunity. We do have two of our board members out today, and then at the end of the meeting, I think two of you are heading straight up to Tallahassee this week, and I'll join the other board member, Dr. Mills, in Tallahassee. So, and then this Thursday, we're going to be, we were invited to present to the Port St. Lucie City Council retreat. And it starts, and so we're going to be first on the agenda at 8:30 on Thursday morning. And two things that they were interested in discussing. One was an update to look really at our multiple use facilities and opportunities for expansion of that. And Marty has been working closely with them. So Marty is going to begin this morning with kind of the presentation, because I wanted our board members to know what we're doing and what some possible opportunities are for expansion, and then we'll share that with the council. And then we'll go into the second piece, which is really, we might get in the weeds with you just for a little bit regarding how we do monitor student achievement, how we know we talk about different programs that are there, and how it really, how we can monitor students as the year goes on, and how it will have a positive effect on our scores at the end. Third grade testing starts today. So, and I had an opportunity just a little while ago to go on the radio to talk to the bus drivers, you know, to thank them for what they do. Most of the times that's the first face the kids see, an official, you know, school face. And they do a nice job of reassuring our students and calming them down. And so we're in testing season. Not to be confused with March Madness, although there could be some kind of a correlation there for another time, right? That wasn't in my notes. All right. So we'll start first with Marty, and he'll make a brief presentation, answer any questions the board have, and then we'll go to the second half with Dr. Prince and Dr. Wild.
Good morning. I want to talk a little bit about mutual use. It's nothing new to the school district. If you're, many of y'all have seen it over the years. Our first interlocal agreement on mutual use came in 1989. We negotiated an agreement with St. Lucie County. We have a current agreement that's in effect through 2020. We have a separate agreements for Lawnwood Stadium and South County Stadium, which I'll talk about a little bit later. City of Port St. Lucie, we entered into our agreement with them in 1991. The current agreement was approved in 2012. It does not have an expiration date, but it's cancelable by either party with a 90-day notice. The long-term leases, again, part of the mutual use we have with the City of Port St. Lucie, we leased Whisper and Pines Park to them for about 23 acres. They've got a lot of development on that as far as park activities, buildings, baseball fields, soccer, tennis courts as well. Windmill Point Elementary, we have football fields behind Windmill Point that's leased to the city, again on a long-term lease. And then Port St. Lucie Elementary site, we lease about 2 acres of that site to them for a little league facility. And facilities leased to the school board at Manatee K-8, when we did the expansion there, we were able to leverage the land that they had there to expand on about almost five acres there. And then Okamic, when we developed that site in 2004, there was 4.1 acres on the east side of that site that we've leased from the city on a long-term lease again, and it's an open play field. The mutual use, a lot of what the city uses are gymnasiums. You can see historically in 2014-15, I just went back 3 years, we had 39 events, about 159 hours. In 15-16, last year, we had 79 events, so almost 350 hours. And this year, booked to date, we have 160 events, over 600 hours of their use, and primarily our gymnasiums. The mutual use agreement, they run their basketball program out of our middle school and K-8 gyms. We use those because they have less conflict than they do in the high schools. If you, you know, you go to high school 6 in the morning, 11 at night, there's somebody there doing something in a gymnasium. So those are more readily available to the city. They have a basketball program. We've already scheduled all the way through the summer. So actually, they've scheduled all the way through August. So we have 78 sessions this year of basketball in our gyms. Let me add to that. To keep their costs down, we work very closely with them. If our people are working, we don't charge them for any custodial time. We let them in. We're taking a little bit off task. We don't charge them for custodial time. And then we also give their employee a key so they can actually come in on Saturday, open up. We give we turn the alarm off for them. And then our custodians come in at the end of the day to clean up and lock up to, again, minimize that cost so we don't just burn up, you know, 10 hours of custodial time because they're in the gym. And it's their employees supervising the gym, so we have a very high comfort level with that.
During the summers, are we running the air conditioning?
We will be running the air conditioning, but they're working outside of those high demand times. So the seasonal demand times between 3 and 6 p.m., they're not starting their practices during the week until 6 p.m., so it doesn't hit us with demand, but we will be using consumption of electricity. And that can be a considerable expense. We have not charged them in the past for it. The agreement gives us an option to charge them for utilities, but we have not been charging them for that. And I've mentioned to them that it's a lot easier to understand during the school day that the gymnasiums are typically the last thing we close down, and the air's running because the custodians are coming for that last cleaning at the end. So the utility cost during the school day is very minor versus on a weekend or during the summer. The county stadiums, it's not related to Port St. Lucie, but it really shows the mutual use that we're doing with our partners. South County Stadium and Lawnwood Stadium, they service all of our high schools except Port St. Lucie. There's 30 football games, 54 soccer games. The county gets about $160,000 in gate receipts. We actually provide a capital expense to the county, and they give us back gate receipts, and that's how we run our athletic program. You know, at best, we did not have to build a stadium, which is a great thing because we're talking $5 to $8 million to build a stadium. But we also have a reduction in our maintenance costs of probably up to $500,000 of what it would take to maintain those two stadiums if we were maintaining it. So it's really a good deal for us, and it gives us a way to run our athletic program as well. The conditions for mutual use, we look at this whenever the city or the county is using our facilities. We require some type of supervision, payment for staff or any direct costs, and utility costs, as I said, we haven't been charging for that historically. The agreement gives us the option to, but we haven't been. And they reciprocate that with our mutual use as well. Potential expansion of facility use. We have Dan McCarty Middle School track. Those are a continued collaboration with the city and the county, City of Fort Pierce and the county. White City Elementary, the basketball courts, that's been in mutual use for about 25 or 30 years with the county. We looked at other outdoor locations that would have minimal cost or require less than intensive supervision. And those we've looked at with Port St. Lucie. Centennial High School, we've got those fields right next to McChesney Park. it's a great opportunity if we enhance the quality of the turf, and it could be a great tournament venue for soccer for the city, because right now they don't have enough fields for a really big tournament. Then the other ones the city's brought up was Southern Oaks Middle School, Bayshore, and Palm Point. Those all have play fields that are external to the building that could be used after hours. We believe, except for Palm Point, that they could be done with minimal amount of supervision. They have a park's gatekeeper come by and unlock the gate, and then at the end of the night they would come by and lock the gate back. And then, you know, again, they have police department and others that would patrol as they would their parks.
This is proposed legislation. I don't know. It's really a grant, a possibility of short-term grants for joint use or mutual use facility usage. Is this for communities? They really want it to priority be communities of need that would have a 50% more free and reduced lunch, of which our entire county would fall into that, in Port St. Lucie as well, even if you just looked at Port St. Lucie. Without looking at all the law itself, I wanted to just share this with the board if this is something that we would be interested in and possibly exploring with our local government agencies. If anybody, you know, whether this gets to the end and is signed, and we don't know yet, because there's a lot of other higher priorities that we're monitoring right now up there. But this would be an opportunity for us to have mutual use and some dollars associated with that within the county. And I'm just looking at the three of you to see if that would, before I say it, anytime in the future, go ahead forward. And if there would be an opportunity to do that, to explore that opportunity with PSL or county or city or all three. Okay. The other thing that we do next, we do partnerships with Port St. Lucie, the Civic Center. We do our DA, our Differentiated Accountability Conference. It's there. We do our Summer Leadership Conference, Teacher Orientation, Culinary Showcase, College Fairs. That's been at a cost of, I think last year was around $18,000. This year it's around $25,000 that we, I don't know, I don't want to say lease the building out, but we
rent it.
We rent it out. And Marty, maybe you know the answer, and maybe the board knows, you know, why isn't that included as like a multi-use where we could get some kind of a discount on that?
And I've inquired with the city, and I'll give you a little history. When Don Cooper was here, he basically said the Civic Center is an enterprise fund, and it's not included in the mutual use. And, you know, dealing with Mr. Cooper, that it was not a discussion item. It was a statement of fact when he declared it. So the city's looking at that, but certainly the way I read the agreement, it doesn't exclude any buildings or any other facilities. And maybe that's something that we can have some additional discussion about, the payment of the utilities in the off hours. May come at a cost, because if it could become very expensive for them. Looking at last year, if we were charging them for utilities, it would have been in the $20,000 range.
So we're looking, see if there's a way to work something out there.
Well, the reality of it is they're not turning on the air just for us, because they run the air regardless.
He's talking about turning our
I'm
air.
Talking
off.
About
our,
no,
but there's, but our summer programs, yeah, where we're
ours
really
is
supplementing
ours
around
$20,000. The only problem is,
dollars,
you know, from their perspective, is it time that they could rent to somebody else when we're using it? And that, you know, for us to take a high priority time, it may be difficult with them losing the revenue.
Well,
but
I can understand that.
Yeah.
Other, so we've talked about the multi-use. One of the things that we're working on in curriculum is the summer, the summer slide, what I call summer slide. The iReady program, we're going to have on our website, and we're going to be getting this out to the different groups. Port St. Lucie has several summer camps where the students can be involved for a certain amount of period, a certain minutes, an hour, or whatever, a day regarding academic activities. And we can supply all that not only to them, but to any agency in the county. You're all aware of SOARS and St. Lucie Reads, the community awareness campaigns. If we were doing something like on attendance or tardies or those kinds of things, we can work together. always encourage folks to be on school advisory councils at the schools, the CTE advisory boards or the career tech boards that are there. Is Terrence here?
Yes, sir.
Terrence, come on up real quick. Terrence, we do some Reader's Digest, what we're doing with the county right sure. now on digital access and maybe some possible opportunities.
Absolutely. So at our current, you know, during the day, we're able to offer all of our students access to Wi-Fi and technology from that perspective. After hours, it becomes a real challenge for us. Current practice, we do have a Comcast solution in place where about 2,750 of our families take care of it. And then we just qualified for the $1 million Sprint project, which will offer free Wi-Fi to our students. In addition to that, we're currently meeting with CIOs from the county level, GCHOW, to look at how we can provide community access to Wi-Fi, starting small and then moving that out so we provide opportunities both to our students and our families for access to free Wi-Fi and technology.
Any questions on that part? Okay. And then lastly on this part, and I'll ask Dr. Prince and Dr. Wall to come on up. These are some potential things that we can do too through our, and they're in your in the handout there, so I'm just gonna go quickly, like through the CTE programs, you can see the different program and where there could be an internship with the city in the different departments. You can see at St. Lucie West Centennial School, the CTE program, the potential. So, and I know we do internships right now through MARTI and through the county, but this could be something that the city may want to explore as well, possible partnerships within that. That concludes that portion of the multiple use. Any questions regarding that?
I just know the mayor's gonna speak up and ask about playgrounds. Has that been a discussion yet, MARTI?
No, it hasn't. They really haven't brought up playgrounds at all.
I'm not sure if he's discussed it with any other board members, but I know that he would like to see maybe Floresta or Bayshore be open to the community after hours. And
well, Bayshore, we did talk about that, and it's less, it does have some playground equipment on the area that we're looking at, but it's primarily open play field with but they haven't had that discussion. Those are areas where we may need supervision if you have playgrounds open. So it's a staffing cost for the city if we do that, so they may not be as energetic.
Well, he also talked about putting bathrooms out there too in certain areas too at their cost.
Right.
So.
And those are the logistics you really have to think about, that mm-hmm. it sounds grand that we opened our gates, but you know, we know from the Okamic history that if you don't have restrooms, that
they'll
find them.
Mm-hmm. That's why I brought that point up.
Yeah.
So just be prepared, he's probably gonna bring that up.
Okay.
Okay, we'll switch gears and go over to our core mission, which is academics, and give an overview of some updates to what we've been doing to improve student performance. I'll turn it over to Dr. Prince.
Good morning. This is gonna be the most exciting part of the show. I can tell you that right now.
That's okay, I have coffee.
You brought coffee, good. I probably should have brought some too. All right, so today is the first day of our third grade testing. I can say it's an exciting day because when you prepare so much, you know our students, and we're very confident our students are gonna perform well. But it is a tremendous amount of pressure on those little third graders because it is a mandatory retention year. So we're gonna get started with having a brief discussion about how schools are graded. Now, our schools are graded based on, and we're gonna start with elementary schools. The top row is basically we have English, language arts, math, and science. And then when it talks about achievement, that are the percentage of students that are on grade level or higher for ELA or language arts. And the language arts test assess their reading and their writing skills for third, fourth, and fifth grade. And then our math skills in third, fourth, and fifth grade. And then our science in fifth grade. And once again, that top row is proficiency. So the percentage of students that are proficient or on grade level or higher. Then we go to learning gains, and that's a percentage of all students for ELA and math that have made growth throughout the year, and I'm going to define that in just a minute. And then they look at your lowest 25%, and that's, once again, the lowest 25% on performance from the previous year on those tests. So middle K-8, they actually add some components. You have a civics test, which is in seventh grade, and once again, what percentage of those students pass that assessment. We have our proficiency component, we have our learning gains, and then once again, we have our learning gains at the lowest 25, and that's 900 points. And then they add acceleration. And acceleration is the percentage of students that pass an EOC, which is an algebra exam. Many of our top performing students take algebra as middle school students or K-8 students. And also some students might take geometry, but they're also industry certification exams, which we've added also in our middle schools. And that is a 900 point scale. And the state looks at what percentage of students, and they set the scale, you need this percentage of points to be an A, a B, a C, a D, and an F. And that can change sometimes from year to year. Finally, we get to high school. My favorite, because it's so complex. Now in high school, it's 9th and 10th ELA. Math, those are EOCs, and that's algebra, geometry, and algebra 2. Science is the biology test. Social studies is the US history test. And what percentage of those students are on grade level or pass those EOCs? And then we look at our learning gains, and then our learning gains of our lowest 25. And I want to accentuate learning gains, because in almost all of these models, learning gains is at least 40% of a school grade. Okay? At least, and in some cases, it's more than half. The high school component also includes the graduation rate. Now, I want to make something clear, because sometimes we have students graduate, but they're graduating as a fifth-year senior, a six-year senior, they're on that five-year plan. The state looks at only at students that graduate in 4 years. That's all the state cares about. Did they graduate in 4 years? They also look at those graduates, those students that walk across that stage as high school graduates. What percentage of those students passed an advanced placement test, passed a dual enrollment course, passed a Cambridge exam, or passed an international baccalaureate exam? And what's also interesting is, because some of these measures aren't taken until way after the school year is over, these are called lagging indicators. So what you earn on a school grade in the summer is really what you earned the previous year. So all the work we're doing for acceleration and graduation rate this year won't show up on these high school grades until the 17-18 school grade, once the 17-18 school grades come out. So the high school grades for this year, they're going to get their graduation rate from the 15-16 school year. Same thing with acceleration.
When you say passing, is passing a D or passing?
Passing is actually scoring a 3 or higher, like on a Cambridge exam. For dual enrollment, it's getting an A, B, or C. So you actually have to pass the test in order to get the college credit. So one thing that's really interesting, and I want to point out to the board, because I'm going to talk about learning gains in just a minute and what the state has done to change that calculation, is we know that economic factors are very closely related to student performance. Okay, and I'm going to actually illustrate this to you. So if you take a look at this slide, and we're about to present to the city of Port St. Lucie, the city has a high interest in the performance of their schools. Well, we're going to start out with illustrating the percentage of students that are on free reduced lunch in those schools. And this is sorted from highest to lowest. And you can see that many of our schools in the city of Port St. Lucie are very economically disadvantaged. This is a percentage of students that are on free reduced lunch. Now I'm going to take that a step further and correlate that to the percentage that are economically disadvantaged. And if you look at their correlation, and this is elementary schools, this is a percentage of level one students, and level one students are significantly, they're more than 1 year behind in their reading and math. So as you can see, the higher the economic challenges, the more level one students, for the most part, that these schools have. And what's interesting, now the grades are a little bit mixed in elementary, but I want to show you the K-8 slide. Look at the free reduced lunch sorted from highest to lowest. Look at the school grade, and then look at the percentage of students that are level one. For the reading, it's almost a direct correlation. So the more challenges you have, it's going to match up with the school grade pretty accurately.
Well, we have to be careful here. Is that these are just facts. That's the stat data that it shows. So it represents, there's more unique challenges, but it is not any reason why the students can't perform at higher levels. It just creates some challenges. It may take longer. It could take, and as John will talk about in a minute with the learning gains and how that compares to how the old rules compare to the new rules. So we don't want to ever send any message that we don't have high standards, that we don't have high expectations, and that we don't have rigor in the classroom. But that there are unique, that is a microcosm of what the United States would show based on poverty. Now you'll find outliers, and we want to be the outlier. We want to have the outliers, and we have that going on already in some places, and we're moving in that direction. But there's a direct correlation, but it's still not an excuse why students can't achieve.
Mr. Chair, it's not easy, no matter what anybody says. It's not easy, and it requires a higher level of professionalism by our educators and counselors to move that needle. So when anybody on a dais says this is an easy thing to do, anybody can do it, that it needs to be called out. It is not easy. It will be done.
Yes.
But it is not easy.
And we're going to talk in just a moment about the graduation rate. And the same intensity that we've approached the graduation rate, I'm going to illustrate to you that we're approaching student achievement as well. Because we make no excuses. All of our students can learn, and we will perform. Now, what's interesting about the high school is the high level of level one students in math. And I just wanted to give you a brief explanation of why that is most of our students take algebra as middle school students. So the students that are sitting in those freshman courses are primarily our lower level students, okay? So what do the levels really mean? Because sometimes we talk about what's a level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, a level 1 student is a year more below grade level. A level 2 student is 6 months below grade level. A level 3, that porridge is just right. That means they're on grade level. And level 4 is 6 months above, and level 5 is a year or more above grade level. Now, for the level 1 and 2 students, these are the students that in many of our schools are more than 60% of our population. These students have to move into the next bucket. That can be up to 2 to 4 years of growth in a year. Now, you have a piece of paper on cardstock, and you're going to get a brief introduction to what a bucket is, because you're going to hear all about buckets if you ever visit a school. That's what the principals and teachers will refer to when they talk about learning gains as buckets. These 3, 4, and 5 students, these students, to get a learning gain, they have to stay in their level plus one. So whatever they had, if they had a score of 301 last year, they've got a score of 302 this year, okay? So let's talk about these buckets. I'm very excited about this. I have no idea. I do get really excited about this stuff. So what they've done is if you're a level one student, in the past a level one student was just a level one student. Now they split the level one students into 3 different buckets. There's a low level bucket, a mid level bucket, and a high level bucket. The level two, they've split into 2 buckets, a low level two and then a high level two. And then you've just got a 3, a 4, and a 5. So for students scoring into 3 or 4, they just have to stay in that level plus one, but if they're a 1 or a 2, they have to jump into the next bucket. It's literally like jumping from bucket to bucket. So, in a nutshell, and I want to kind of oversimplify this a little bit, before 2015, this was the philosophy of the state. A year's growth in a year's time. That's what the state expected. So if you're a teacher in a classroom, and I have a 7th grade student, and this happens all the time, and they're on a 4th grade reading level, then I was expected to get that child to a 5th grade reading level. Okay, that's a year's growth in a year's time. Well, now the state has created these buckets. So if I've got a ninth grade student on a fifth grade reading level, and we see that all the time, that child might need to be at a seventh grade reading level in order to get into the next bucket. So the gain that they're expected to make is amplified. It's more than 2 years in some instances. So the mountain just got higher. In the past, a student was asked to climb the mountain, and now they might be climbing a mountain that's two or three times as high as they used to. So this is my quick bucket exercise. I know Mr. Ingersoll is really fired up about this one. I can tell. So I gave you a sheet, and it breaks down all the grades for ELA, math, and end-of-course exams. So let's focus on English and math and end-of-course. So I've got my little arrows there. So this is the low-level one. So this is the scoring range for a low-level one student, the middle bucket, the high bucket. The principals have seen this slide 1,000 times, and so have the teachers. The level two has a low-level bucket and a high-level bucket, and then we've got the 3, 4, and 5 buckets. And this is great because I can use this one sheet for every single one of my calculations. So if I'm a third grade student, okay, and I'm in the lower level bucket, I've got to move to the middle. If I'm in the middle bucket, I've got to move to the high. If I'm in the high bucket for level one, I've got to go to the low level two bucket, and so on and so forth. If I'm in the low level two, I go to the high level two. If I'm in the high level two, I've got to go into level three. And then I've got my plus one rule for 3s, 4s, and 5. So what's the philosophy behind this? I just want, you know, the state always has a reason for doing something. The reason is, if I'm growing a year's growth, sometimes they don't, Mrs. Hensley, sometimes we just really don't know why the state's doing something. But the philosophy is, let's say I'm a seventh grade student and I'm on a third grade reading level, okay? If I grew a year in a year's time, I'd never be proficient. I would never be proficient. So this model shows a fifth grade student in a low level bucket, and over 5 years, if I make my bucket jumps, by the time I'm in 10th grade, I can be proficient. So the plan is to get every student proficient within 5 years. And that's the purpose behind it. So what's the impact? If I just said that the mountain got higher for learning gains, this has a direct correlation to our school grades. So this slide illustrates the fact that the majority of our schools stayed the same or declined both within our district and statewide. And that is literally due to our the adjustment in school in learning gains. The same thing as district grades. 32 counties dropped the letter grade. 34 stayed the same, and only one district improved their letter grade. So that learning gain impact was felt statewide. Now, what Mr. Gent was addressing, you know, we make no excuses for the challenges. It's, we have what we call our metrics, that what are the things that we're gonna look at a school when we meet with principals, and we meet monthly with principals, and I meet every 2 months with our high school principals with regards to graduation rate and acceleration. What are our high return on investment metrics that we're going to closely measure that is going to give us the outcomes that we expect all of our students to perform? So our first initiative this year was, and I know you can't see this, but I'm just gonna talk about it briefly, is our unit assessments. And our unit assessments were designed basically with our teachers, and we can see, this is math, okay? So I'm looking at fourth grade math, and this is unit assessment 1, 2, 3, and 4. And these are our schools. So we can see what schools are performing well and what strategies are they using to perform so well. And what can we replicate in other schools? Like, what are they doing? It also informs us of where do we need to provide additional support. And we can do this in real time. We meet every other Wednesday, and we talk about where are we going to provide additional support to schools, and it creates a very fluid process for us. It also drives our PLCs, our professional learning communities, with our teachers. This is one particular school. This is Fairlawn, And this is our fourth unit assessment in math. And this is all of our teachers in one particular grade level. And we can see how those students did on that particular unit assessment. Now, this is invaluable information if I'm one of these teachers and I'm working collaboratively to plan, because if you're my colleague and your students perform very, very well on this particular assessment, it's the same assessment. So what strategies did you use in your classroom that maybe I can replicate in mine? Okay. And also, if we need additional support, let's say we have a new teacher that's struggling, what additional support can we provide to this teacher to assist her? Does she need a mentor? Does he need additional support in the classroom? So I know Dr. Wild's going to talk about iReady. So iReady is both a diagnostic tool and an instructional tool. She's going to talk about it as the instructional tool. I'm going to talk about it briefly as a diagnostic tool, because three times throughout the year, the students take an iReady diagnostic that has, especially when they take the second and third one, it has a high predictability on how the student is going to perform on the FSA. Now, just to show you, it clearly indicates, but what percentage of students in third grade and fourth grade are likely to score proficient on the iReady reading diagnostic? Well, for grade three, the number is 48%. Now, last year, we were at 46% in third grade. Now, this has a plus or minus of 3%, so we could perform possibly at 5%, or we could perform consistently with what we did last year. The good news across grade levels is we're seeing positive numbers in all of our grades, which supports the probability that we're going to see remarkable or improved performance from grades 3 through 8, because that's what iReady assesses. We're plus 6 currently in fourth grade, which once again, that would be at about the state average, which is good for us because in the past we performed below the state average. It also looks at our K-2 students as well. Now, this assessment was done in the fall and in the winter. So the light blue is the performance of the students in the fall. The dark blue is the performance in the winter. And you can see the impressive growth that our K-1 and 2 students have had. And if I just highlight one particular grade, which I'm trying to do, first grade, 16% proficiency in window 1, and that moved to 41% in window 2. So, you know, I can summarize and just say that we're making some real impressive progress, and I'm very excited to see how the students are going to perform, because I think that the metrics that we're using and the progress monitoring that we're doing is having a real positive impact in our schools. So I want to go back to high school, because this is something that I know the superintendent is very proud of, and we should be very proud of as a district. Graduation rate and acceleration. As a former high school principal, this was like herding cats, okay, because it was very difficult to measure. Graduation rate has so many variables. Acceleration success has so many variables. So our graduation rate was 87% last year. Okay, we went up substantially. That is not smoke and mirrors. That is not through some whiz-bang hiding something. Let me just explain to you what that graph you're seeing right now is between 2013 and 2016. The green is the number of students who graduated and walked across as a high school graduate. The red or orange are students who received a certificate of completion. Now, a certificate of completion is a ceiling in many instances on what our students can do. And a high school diploma, it opens doors for our students and provides opportunities for the world of career and work. Now, our certificates of completion were reduced by more than 90 last year, and we had more than 130 additional graduates. So that's not, you can't work that system. The bottom line is we had a tremendous amount more graduates than we did from one year to the next, and that's just simple math. Okay? So how do we do that? How was that accomplished? Okay? It wasn't easy. First of all, what I talked about, it's like herding cats. There are so many requirements for graduation now. If you remember your high school experience, I just remember I kind of showed up every day and managed to get my high school diploma. We have so many requirements now with our EOCs, or 30% of the grade. You have to pass, and I want to emphasize this. Our board members know that you have to pass the 10th grade test, and the ELA, and you have to pass the algebra exam. Those two things are primarily what prevents our students from graduating with a high school diploma. But they also have all these other requirements, 4 credits in English, 4 credits in math, 3 credits in science, they have to take biology, social studies, a credit in art, physical education, 8 electives, and they have to have a 2.0 GPA. So we have all these measurements that we have to follow. So one of the biggest challenges for us is how do the principals progress monitor this when there's so many variables? It's very, very difficult. So we work collaboratively with IT. I want to give kudos to Terrence, and I think Pedro's here. Pedro, wave. There you go, Pedro. We work collaboratively with an absolutely fantastic IT team, and we basically said, okay, these are all the things that our high schools need to measure. How can we create a database that our principals can see in real time how our students are performing? Now, it's what started out as a really long spreadsheet. I'm going to show you what has evolved into what's about to be rolled out. So I said that the number one thing that holds students back is the reading and the math requirement. Well, right now at Treasure Coast High School, Treasure Coast High School's graduation rate last year was 91%. So right now, when I pull this up, I can see that 91% of the students at Treasure Coast have met both the reading and the math today. And I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to tell you if Treasure Coast is going to get to 95% or higher, because this time last year, they were at about 82%. And I'm going to show you all the back work that we do to build ourselves up for success, and not just focusing on seniors, how to systematically approach it from freshman to sophomore to junior to senior. So we also drill down into how the students are performing. And this is at the principal's fingertips. So we have our student name here. I can look at the GPA of my students. I can see how many credits they've completed. I can even get into whether they're on free reduced lunch, what economic impact they have, whether they're an LEP student, whether they're an ESE student. They might qualify for a waiver, for a testing waiver. This is all information that prior to a year ago, a principal or a guidance counselor would have had to go into Skyward and go student by student by student. Do you know how much time that takes? When I've got this information at the end of first semester last year, we had built this and it was going out to principals every 2 weeks. So whenever I met with principals, we would break down, okay, what are our strategies to make sure that these students pass this assessment? What kind of remediation are they getting? Where are they at with their credit recovery if they don't have a 2.0 GPA? All of these things, graduations don't just magically happen. It takes work, and our principals and our staffs did a lot of work to get to 87%. We also looked at school grades, and when I say school grades, I mean teacher grades. And I'm not saying that to say, okay, this teacher gave more Fs than another teacher. What we looked at is really grading practices, grading equity, and also what are the courses that students are failing? Okay, and if we have such a high failure rate in these courses, then what prerequisite skills do kids need to have, okay, in order to be successful in those classes? So we looked individually at teachers, we looked at courses, and also we looked at, okay, if students are failing a course, what other courses can they take that can set them up for success? All right, this is the most exciting part of the show for me. Any questions before I go here? All right.
Is it, it's hard to see from up here.
Okay. So, here we are. What? Why? I don't know if I want to know.
I'll tell you later.
Okay. All right. So.
I used to make them read their notes if they passed them in class.
Yes. I won't do that. Not yet. So this is really exciting as a high school principal because this allows us to take a look from a visual representation. All of our principals in about a week and a half are going to have access to this. And you know how you go on your email and you click on email? This is going to be on what is called the waffle, okay, which is just if I want to go to my calendar, or let's say I want to go to grad progress monitoring. So it's harder to see, but in the top left, that lists all of our schools that are high schools in St. Lucie County. And this is just a starting point because this shows our graduating class. It shows how many students. It shows a demographic breakdown, how many males, females, how many African-American, white, Hispanic students. So this shows everything. And if I want to drill down to one school, Terrence, take me to Central. It's going to show me my current enrollment. It's going to show me how many freshmen, sophomore, junior, seniors I have. And this information is really not that critically important to me, but it just shows you the size of the school and the demographic breakdown of the school. So let's take a look at, in the very bottom, the percentage of students that have met the math and the reading requirement. So if I looked as a district, the percentage of students, and I know that's hard to see, but he can hover over it, it's going to show that 83% of our students have met both the reading and the math requirement, and it's only March. We had 87% last year. I've told the superintendent that we're going to be sitting here next year, and our graduation rate for St. Lucie County, I feel very confident saying I think we can hit 90%. Because we were probably at about 71% this time last year. Now, I can also, in the middle, Terrence, go to 2018. Because
his paychecks on it.
I'm feeling pretty confident today. I think I might, because I think we can get there. And actually, if we hit a 90% graduation rate, we would be in the top five in the state. So I also can click on 2018, and I can see that about 58%, 59% of our students have met the reading for those juniors. 59% of them have met that. Now, if you remember, we just had our school-wide SAT. I know at Westwood alone, we had almost 50 juniors meet the reading requirement. Now, these numbers haven't even been updated to reflect that. But we're doing so much work with our freshmen, sophomore, juniors, and seniors. This is no longer looking at our graduation rate just for our senior class. It's how can we set ourselves up for success moving forward. Now, let's take a look at one particular school. Let's look at Treasure Coast for 2018. Yeah, we'll go 18. And she's at 59% of the juniors. And my guess is that number is going to get into the 70s after the SAT results come out. So this is great because we're going to have also the high school principals are very competitive if you know them. So we're very transparent. Whenever I click on a toolbar, I'll be able to show who's met the reading requirement and the math requirement both for all of the high schools. So I can see if I'm at Fort Pierce Central. We were number one last year at Fort Pierce Central with graduation rate. Treasure Coast was right behind. I can tell you right now that Susan Sia wants to be number one. And she wants to know Todd's numbers all the time. So this will allow the availability for them to look and see how their colleagues and the schools are doing. And if we have outliers, what strategies are they doing? We also know that acceleration is part of the accountability system. There's a tab on the bottom for CTE APIB. We can click on that. And if you see the green bars, okay, that's the percentage of students that have met that requirement that are seniors right now. And if I go to, let's try Central again. Central last year was at 50%. Terrence, what does that say? So right now, we're only in March, 51% of Mr. Smith's seniors have met that requirement, and we haven't even started testing yet for CTE for those students. So his numbers are going to go up substantially. But this is a way from the principals to monitor progress in real time. This is completely interactive. So if I want a list of kids that have not met a requirement or are not on track to graduate, I can drill down and get a listing of those students. I can't thank IT enough for the great work that they've done, because we are so far ahead of the real large districts that the capabilities that we have, it's unbelievable what their team has managed to do to make our jobs that much easier. So thanks. Lastly, hold up your phone, Terrence. This is also available on our smartphones. So if I'm in Tahiti or I'm in the Keys and I'm a principal and I want to look and see how my graduation rate is progressing, I can pull this up. I can pull this up at any time. Now, we're also taking this advanced metrics approach whenever we have another board workshop. We're also doing the same thing in HR, in recruiting, retentions, the same data points that we use to be successful in our academics and our graduation rate. We're applying that to HR, and we're going to be sharing some of those exciting things with what we've done and what we've discovered. Stay tuned in the coming months. Dr. Watt.
Good morning, everyone. As Dr. Prince mentioned, I was going to review iReady a little bit, just go back to that topic briefly.
Sorry.
Before we're transitioning and we're almost done, any questions for Dr. Prince on that? The live dashboard, that was original kind of from Terrence, and Terrence is on, what is it, Terrence, what are you on, what is it?
The Power BI.
Power BI.
The Power Beyond.
Power BI.
Power BI.
Is that what he said?
Power BI.
Power BI, I thought I said the Power Beyond.
He's good,
Power your sermon Sunday. I'll help you out with it. Free. But the idea is that he gets on from the latest, greatest things that are out there and how we can transform that through education and through the education system is remarkable, not just for student performance, but for recruitment. It's really, really, there's a lot of potential there. And so we're very fortunate to have our entire team. We were only successful because of a great team, but Terrence went out to Washington or Seattle or someplace and came back with us, and he was all pumped up. So I really want to give him kudos, as well as Dr. Prince and all the departments that are doing this, because this is kind of really unique for us.
Well, and if I may, Mr. Chair, amongst all the discussion of being competitive and all those kind of things, the main focus is individual instruction, so the success of each child. So that is the baseline for those watching. I don't want them to think that we've gone away from that into a different mode, but that is our baseline.
Well, that's absolutely true. And as a former high school principal, the thing I was most proud of is students graduating. Because I knew that if a student graduated high school, then all kinds of doors open for them to be successful. And as a district, our schools have done a remarkable job of making sure those doors remain open for those students. So you're absolutely correct, Ms. Hensley.
So you can get the big picture, but then why we were so successful is that's the key. You break it down one-on-one for what each child needs, whether it's third grade reading or graduation. EOC or whatever it would be, it goes down to the individual, and that's the that's why I call it the advocacy. It's like an advocacy for each child, so it's a win-win.
Good morning. So we are simultaneously working to make sure that when these students graduate, that they are also college and career ready, and we have implemented.
Let me set this up. So one of the things that I apologize for interrupting it twice. I was going to make a weak joke. I'm not allowed to do that at home. Yeah. One of the things that the city had asked in their resolution was to look at joint use or mutual use, which we've talked about. The other thing that they talked about was proposing being proponents of a centralized industrial arts program. We that is not on our radar. That is something we don't need, and we're going to give the rationale behind that now. So a lot of the stuff that Dr. Prince talked about was for our board only today. That was in the weeds kind of thing, so that's not going to be part of the present.
Oh, we're not going to do that?
Some of it. Oh. We can talk to you about it. We can talk about that because we know we're limited in time. But this kind of goes in and ties into what we are doing academically, and it's more of a Reader's Digest version of that and how the iReady ties into that, and then we'll get into career tech programs and what we're offering. And if I don't stop, I'll give her a presentation.
That's okay. Thank you, Mr. Jay. Like I said, we want the students to be graduating college and career ready, and that takes a lot of strategies, K through 12, to make that happen, and it does, or pre-K through 12. One of the major initiatives that we implemented this year in grades K through 8 has been iReady, and Dr. Prince referred to it. It is really a personalized learning system for our students. And very briefly, I know you guys know this, just a quick review, it has several components. And the one that Dr. Prince and all of us utilize to measure progress is really the diagnostic that's given three times a year. But just as importantly, that tool also personalizes the curriculum for the student three times a year, adjusting as they develop and increase their skill level. So the diagnostic then leads into the instructional component. And that instructional component has several benefits to the teacher. It allows for differentiated instruction both on the computer, where the student sits down and has their own personalized plan on the computer, and by providing lesson plans to the teachers that tell them which students to group together for which skill deficits. Great tool for teachers that they didn't have prior to this implementation. And then it individually remediates missing skills or skill gaps for students. It is supplementary. It is not the core curriculum. It is not on standard. It is where the student is at that particular point. So it could even be an enrichment tool if the student is above level. We want to emphasize that this is also available for students at home. When they are at home, their personalized plan continues. They have access to it. There is a tutorial component, guided practice, and an activity that they do with every lesson. And we do encourage students to strive to hit 45 minutes weekly. That's just the number that yields the most positive results for students. We are now doing community outreach because we want anybody who provides services to students after school or in the summer to be aware that this program is available and that their students can access it. We are putting together a comprehensive list to make sure that we are sharing that news with everybody, as well as providing any technical assistance that might be necessary to summer camps, community agencies, and so forth. And this is part of our Summer Slide initiative. Any questions about that? Okay. In addition, we are always encouraging students to strive for the highest level of academics possible. And we do have college preparatory and college level programs in all of our high schools. We don't want that to be forgotten. It's very important that everyone be aware that Port St. Lucie High and Lincoln Park Academy have international baccalaureate. And the Port St. Lucie High program is rapidly growing right now. More and more students are attending for that program. We also have expanded the ACE program with the University of Cambridge that used to be only at Treasure Coast High School. It is now also growing rapidly at St. Lucie West Centennial High School. We continue to have increasing numbers of students in dual enrollment at all of our high schools, as well as advanced placement at all of our high schools. And I'll go back to advanced placement in just a moment.
So how many students are in IB at Port St. Lucie High School?
I have that information on all of those, but I don't have it at my fingertips right now. I can send it to you.
Just for Thursday.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Also, we have started some college preparatory programs in our middle schools. We are in the process of applying for a school-wide middle school IB program at Southport Middle School. That is a long process, so we are at the end of the first year of preparation for that process. In addition, this year we implemented pre-AP, the springboard curriculum, in three of our middle schools. trained four of our middle schools. Westgate will be adding it for next year. We're phasing that in grade by grade. That does take some time to implement because it also requires a different scope and sequence to make sure that all of the standards required in that grade level are hit at the appropriate proportion. Our AP participation rate did increase this year. This was just notable because you don't really ever see participation increase and also see performance increase. And that is what we accomplished this past year. We had a 30% participation increase, and the results increased by 26%. So that's very exciting. We also have been encouraging more students to take the PSAT. As you are well aware, we do administer the PSAT to all 10th graders. It is a great tool for them. Gives us a lot of valuable information and gives the student and teachers a lot of valuable information. But we are encouraging more and more students to take it again in 11th grade. And so we did see an increase with our juniors, 86% increase, and still were able to have higher than the state average performance on the PSAT. And the big change for this year that we are so thrilled about is that we have a partial partnership with the Florida College Board this year, which has allowed us to give the SAT to all of our juniors at no cost to us or to them. That is a wonderful benefit of the partnership. We are seeking to get full partnership next year. That has to be legislatively approved, and we're in that process right now. That partnership includes not only the free SAT, but a lot of free training as well. Free mentors for the new AP computer science class for those teachers. A lot of benefits are built into that partnership. Dr. Prince hasn't seen the results. They're coming in this morning of the SAT school day, and he happened to pull up Treasure Coast High School. Treasure Coast High School had 103 students pass the concordance score. 43% of the juniors that need it to graduate passed with this administration on that one day. So that's just an example. And we're still waiting for ESE results to come in. So all of those are coming in countywide. We are very grateful to the board for supporting our adoption of the Naviance software. As you recall, when we presented this last year, it was new to us. It's a web-based college and career readiness planning and tracking tool. It's very, very robust. It goes from grade 6 through grades 12. We were the first Florida district to come on board with Naviance, and now there's a large network of districts that have come on board, and they're kind of following our implementation plan. There's a lot of training involved, so it's a phased-in implementation. I think you have the scope and sequence there that goes from 6th grade through 12th grade. There are required activities that the students must take, and then there's optional additional supplemental activities. It has given our guidance counselors a wonderful tool. It allows us to meet the middle school career exploration component straight through Naviance, as well as provide freshman seminar teachers with a great curriculum.
So when the question comes up, what are we doing at the middle school level or early grader levels? This is the beginning of that, where you do career exploration, what the student might be interested in, that then tie them into whatever that career academy or CTE program could be within the district. And we're in our second year of the implementation of it, really the first year. We started last year, but you worked the kinks out within that, and the career exploration resource, because some folks will say, well, not everybody's college material. We've always said it's college and career, you know, no emphasis one way or the other, but to make sure that the kids know about the opportunities that are for them, no matter what path they choose in working with their parents.
Who goes, because this is a question that has been brought up by the city before in the past. I'm glad you spoke right there. But whose responsibility is it? Is it the guidance counselor? Is it the teacher? Could you tell me?
To make sure that students are participating in Naviance.
Participating and then get the follow-up rather than just the computer talking to them.
Yes, it's actually, I mentioned the word comprehensive because it truly is from grade 6 through 12, and it's a combined effort. The guidance counselors do much of it. In 8th grade, though, where there's a heavier emphasis, it's also done in the classroom. There's a course called U.S. History with Career Explorations, so there's a component of it that's done in conjunction with the guidance counselor as part of their class time. That continues with freshman seminar as well. The primary individuals responsible for the implementation and follow-up are the guidance counselors. And they have all the reports. They can pull at their fingertips a list of any student who has expressed an interest in any career cluster or any college. So it really has streamlined and informed their work with students. Any other questions? Okay, moving on to career technical education. We have amazing programs in our school district, and people are always impressed when they visit a school and see what is happening. But we also have other indicators of success. For our students that complete a CTE program sequence, which is a minimum of 3 courses in a related field, the graduation rate for those completers is 97%. The skills that they develop there, they're skills that employers are looking for. And 51% of our students in grades 9 through 12 are enrolled in at least one CTE program. That 51% would include seniors who have already completed their program, would be in the other 49%, students that are in off-campus and dual enrollment or in performing arts or other areas of academic exploration. We also have strong partnerships with Indian River State College and other institutions where the students can take their CTE credits, and it leads right into a post-secondary CTE major and earns them credits. This is a snapshot of our enrollment by school in CTE courses, and you can see the range all the way up to 59% at Port St. Lucie High School. Oops, sorry, I went too fast there. And I mentioned that experience going through a CTE program does show employers that the students are coming to them with the skills they need, and sometimes with actual credentials. The credentials are in the form of industry certifications. In St. Lucie County, we currently offer our students 44 industry certifications. If you count the number on there, there's actually 39, but some of them have different levels of certification that within that field are considered separate industry certifications. And we just broke them down a little bit more so that you could see what areas we are certifying our students in. As you know, the skills gap analysis showed 1,400 future jobs in the healthcare industry. That is one of our most popular CTE areas for our students, and you can see all of the industry certifications that allow students to enter the field credentialed are there listed. We also have on the left-hand side our industry trade-related certifications in the area of architecture and carpentry and manufacturing. As well, on the right-hand side, we have our industry certifications in the automotive industry, and we have a lot of partnerships in those industries as well. We have a lot of student interest in technology-based industry certifications. The students have a repertoire of industry certifications they can earn in our schools and then bring that skill to an employer. I personally know students who have used these certifications and landed wonderful careers, either instead of college or after college. And then we also have agricultural and veterinary medicine certifications. Those are housed at Fort Pierce Westwood. You can actually see we also offer certification in unmanned aircraft systems, or commonly known as drones, because drones have some real meaningful uses in industry at this time.
Did you see the news last night when they were tracking the guy down at Martin County to Palm Beach, and it was the drone, it was their drones that did the heat detector that found him out on the alligator infested waters, as they say.
Yes. At the top of this slide, you see the 8 meta majors. Indian River State College and a lot of colleges have clustered their course offerings so that there are clear career pathways for students. We have pathways that feed all of these 8 clusters, and it's not really possible to capture them all on one slide, so this is a sampling, so you can see some natural feeder patterns into their meta majors, and there are many more than that. Summer slide, go ahead.
Yeah, we've talked about the summer slide, and we have some slides in there. regarding that, but for the, unless you want to go through that real quick, we're, I think you're pretty much aware of that. And then I wanted to wrap it up with any questions that you would have. Part of Helen's presentation at the end was something that we are going to share at Port St. Lucie to counteract why we don't need an industrial arts center. If there's any feedback you want to give me publicly or privately, that's fine too regarding that. But I wanted to open up to any general questions that anybody have before I bring, we go to the net. We just have a real quick update for you on some charter school stuff.
I don't have any questions, but I do have a statement. As you know, there have been a couple of people who accused the district of hiding numbers to make our graduation rate to look artificially high. I will guarantee the public that we did not do what the Texas miracle was of the early 2000s, if you recall, under Dr. Page, who became the Secretary of Education for the federal government, that what they ended up doing was actually disenrolling kids who were not going to be able to pass and then re-enrolling them after the testing date. And that made their graduation rate literally look like a miracle instead of a ruse. And we don't do that.
Anything else? All right, thanks, staff. I'm going to bring Jonathan up very, very quickly. We're going to shift gears and a couple of handouts regarding a Imagine Now Charter School in Somerset and a potential merger.
Good morning. Staff was approached a couple months ago by both the representatives for Imagine Now and for Somerset Academy about the possibility of Somerset Academy taking over the Imagine Now Charter School. We've had some discussions with them on the best way to approach that. There's an outline that I handed out. It shows you the time frame. Imagine Now has 1 year left on its current charter. It will expire in June of 2018. So starting this fall, we would start the normal renewal evaluation process. So in discussions with Somerset and Imagine Now and staff, it was felt that probably the best and least disruptive process for the existing families who are attending Imagine Now would be to process a simple amendment to the Imagine Now charter, which would allow Somerset Academy to take over that charter. Currently, Imagine Now does not have the right to unilaterally assign its charter to Somerset. It does require school board approval. What would happen is that the Somerset Academy board would take over the school, but the charter would remain in place. So basically nothing would happen for the foreseeable future with Imagine Now, because they would still be bound by all the same terms and conditions that are in place now. It would simply be a change in the governance board, but not in the day-to-day operations. Those would be discussions we would have when they come in and ask for a renewal. So what would happen, their goal is to have the transition by July 1 of this year. So what would happen is we would come to the school board with a relatively simple item that would approve the assignment of the contract from Imagine Now to Somerset, and then they would continue on next year operating the school. They would probably change the name to avoid confusion, but as far as applications, acceptance, that would remain the same. It would not be the similar to College Prep, which has, for example, a 2.0 minimum academic requirement. So at the end of the day, what we would have in July would be two Somerset Academy schools in St. Lucie County. The Somerset College Prep, which recently amended its charter to add grades 6-8, would be a standalone 6-12 school in their new facility located in St. Lucie West. And then the Imagine Now school would become a Somerset Academy K-8 school located at the existing Imagine Now facility.
Okay.
they would be taking over that facility.
Board members, is there any questions? Thank you.
That's all. Just wanted to give you all an update what's moving forward.
That completes our portion. If the board has any questions on anything that's going on, or
board members?
Not specifically. I just think we need to be extremely vigilant. We need to follow the charter school bills that are up there that are proceeding that will not serve us well and probably won't serve students well. We also need to be following, we have to follow everything, because right now the House has been sort of in disarray, but it appears as of last night the Senate might be in some level of disarray. And the Speaker of the House had made the statement that we will probably be in overtime when it comes to budget. As you know, several years ago, Jeb Bush was the governor. They didn't get a budget approved till after we were all in arrears of state law. And hopefully we don't get to that point again, but the money that they are talking about is not necessarily new money to FTE. It's new money set aside for incoming students to the state. There's a concern about the money that goes to vouchers that is a 25% automatic allocation every year without going back to the legislature. And that's an unfortunate thing, because that should be looked at every year. So there's a lot of things we have to be cognizant of.
Not only at the state, at the federal level as well, with the changes that are going on there, you know, we're monitoring very closely our title budgets, and we were told to prepare for a 3% cut. Now we've been told to prepare for a 7% cut. So that's something that we're working with the principals on and looking at the budgetary impact. But it's, you know, until we get to May or June, when and if it ends, it's gonna have a direct impact on us. And so we're working closely with Vern and Nicole.
They're still looking at too about not allowing the school district to charge to get Medicaid reimbursement for some of our students and all those type of things. Everything that they talk about has either a direct or an ancillary effect on our educators as well as on our kids and the budget of the district. So it's a very interesting time.
If I can just...
Yes, sir, go ahead. No.
Just wanted to mention, this is just an announcement that Mrs. Hensley is a finalist again for the Pete Hegner Award, and we've bought a table for April 26th, 7th. Okay, I think it's a Thursday night. And so if you're interested, let Chris know, and we can dress you up and put a tie on you.
Ms. Holly, any comments? I just want to personally thank you two for going to Tallahassee to represent the children of St. Lucie County in both your areas, and we really appreciate your service.
You're welcome. We will be significantly frustrated by Thursday evening, we think.
I'm sure the superintendent will be too. That concludes our board meeting. Thank you for watching us on TV.